Welcome everyone. Today we will introduce dynamic mode decomposition, so-called DMD, one of popular data-driven approaches. We will go over a complete derivation of DMD today. To understand and follow this tutorial, I assume that you have some background on linear algebra, such as eigenvalue decomposition, characteristics of orthogonal matrices, and singular value decomposition, and so on. All right, let's get into it. Let's say you have some image data which describes some sort of dynamics in time, but you do not know the governing equations and you want to come up with a model which describes these dynamics. One way of getting a model is to use dynamic mode decomposition, so-called DMD, which was first introduced by Peter Schmidt in his famous JFM paper in 2010. DMD first takes each snapshot image data one by one, starting from first time step to second, third, and so on until the last time step. And then you vectorize each time step image data again, starting from the first time step image to second, and so on until the last time step, and call each vector U1, U2, etc. to UM, which is the last time step vector. Then DMD constructs two matrices out of these vectors. First one is U minus matrix, where it holds the first time step image vector to the second to the last time step image vector in column wise. Second one is U plus matrix, where it holds the second time step image vector to the last time step image vector again in column wise. Then DMD tries to come up with a linear operator A that maps U minus matrix to U plus matrix. The operator A can be considered as a linear map that updates one time step image to the next time step image data. Basically, DMD assumes that whatever the dynamics we got as a series of image data, they can be modeled with a linear update. That is quite an assumption. Of course, it would be hard to find a linear operator that exactly maps one time step image to the next time step image for every single time step. So DMD tries to find an operator A that does the update approximately. Of course, one way of finding such an operator is by solving the following minimization problem. Well, this minimization problem actually has an analytical solution, which is U plus matrix times pseudo inverse of U minus matrix. Now what? Are we done? No, of course not. We have a problem here. Unfortunately, the size of the matrix can be pretty huge depending on the size of each image data, and of course, it depends on the application, but n can be a large number, such as million or billion or even trillion. Furthermore, it is dense. Believe me, you do not want to deal with a large-scale dense matrix. Therefore, DMD reduces the dimension of the operator A. To reduce, it applies a singular value decomposition to U minus matrix, where W is an orthonormal matrix whose size is n by r. R here is a small number, such as 10 or 20. Sigma is a diagonal matrix that holds R singular values in its diagonal. V is also an orthonormal matrix whose size is m minus 1 by R, where m is the number of time steps you have in your data. Note the approximation sign here. It is because this is a truncated singular value decomposition. We have reduced the rank of U minus matrix effectively to R, which is again a small number, such as 10 or 20. Now, going back to the goal of DMD, that is U plus approximated by A operator times U minus, we would like to find the operator A by solving least squares problems. And the solution of the least squares problem is given as U plus times pseudo inverse of U minus. Since we have a truncated single value decomposition of U minus, we can get the pseudo inverse of U minus as V times sigma inverse times W transpose. Plugging this into A matrix expression above, we get A equals U plus times V times sigma inverse times W transpose. Note that the matrix A is N by N, which can be a large scale dense matrix. Again, we do not want to deal with large dense matrix. So we would like to form a reduced matrix A by multiplying both sides by projection matrix W transpose from the left, which gives us W transpose times A equals W transpose times U plus times V times sigma inverse times W transpose. Now multiplying both sides from the right by W matrix, we get W transpose times A times W equals W transpose times U plus times V times sigma inverse times W transpose times W. Note that W transpose times W is an identity matrix because W is an orthonormal matrix. Thus, we end up with a reduced A matrix, A hat, equals W transpose times U plus times V times sigma inverse, where A hat is defined as W transpose times A times W. Note that the size of this matrix is small, that is R by R. Furthermore, the formation of A hat matrix only requires a series of matrix-matrix multiplications whose size is matrix of R and N. This is actually manageable. Now let's derive how this reduced operator A hat maps the previous time step data to the next time step data. To see this, we will plug this A operator into the full space update equations. Then we see that U plus matrix gets approximated by U plus times V times sigma inverse times W transpose times U minus. Multiplying both sides by W transpose from the left, we get W transpose times U plus gets approximated by W transpose times U plus times V times sigma inverse times W transpose times U minus. Here, W transpose times U plus projects the full space U plus data into a reduced space that is spanned by W orthonormal matrix. Thus, if we denote W transpose times U plus as U hat plus, and similarly denote W transpose times U minus as U hat minus, then we get U hat plus is approximated by W transpose times U plus times V times sigma inverse times U hat minus. Note that this middle part is exactly the same as A hat matrix. Therefore, we see that the reduced operator A hat is effectively mapping reduced previous data set to the next time step reduced data set. Now what? Once the linear operator is known, either for big U hat matrices or small U hat vectors, where U hat k minus 1 is a k minus 1th time step reduced state vector, we can actually derive an analytical solution for the linear dynamics by first forming an eigenvalue decomposition of the linear operator A hat matrix. X is a matrix with eigenvectors in its columns. Lambda is a diagonal matrix with its eigenvalues in its diagonal. You can bring X in the left-hand side to the right-hand side, which gives A hat equals X times lambda times X inverse. Plugging this eigenvalue decomposition into this A hat matrix, we get U hat K vector approximated by X times lambda times X inverse times U hat K minus 1. Multiplying both sides by X inverse, we get X inverse times U hat K approximated by lambda times X inverse times U hat K minus 1. Let's define X inverse U hat K as U tilde K. Similarly, let's define X inverse U hat K minus 1 as U tilde K minus 1. Then we get U tilde K approximated by lambda times U tilde K minus 1. Now, note that U tilde K minus 1 can be approximated by lambda times U tilde K minus 2. Therefore, we get U tilde K approximated by lambda times U tilde K minus 2, which is lambda squared times U tilde K minus 2. We can repeat this induction, for example, lambda squares times lambda times U u tilde k minus 3, which is lambda cubed times u tilde k minus 3. And so on, at the end, we get u tilde k approximated by lambda kth power times u tilde 0. Now let's bring this over here and recall that u tilde k is x inverse times u hat k. And also recall that u tilde 0 is x inverse times u hat 0. This gives us that x inverse times u hat k is approximated by lambda kth power times x inverse times u hat 0. Now, multiplying both sides by x, we get u hat k approximated by x times lambda kth power times x inverse times u hat 0. Now, recall that u hat k is w transpose times u sub k. Similarly, u hat 0 is w transpose u 0. So this gives w transpose times u sub k approximated by x times lambda kth power times x inverse times w transpose times u 0. Multiplying both sides by w, we get w times w transpose times u sub k approximated by w times x times lambda kth power times x inverse times w transpose times u 0. Now w times w transpose times u sub k can be considered as an approximation of u sub k. And if we set w times x as phi matrix, then we can show in the next slide that x inverse times w transpose is pseudo inverse of phi. Now then we get u sub k approximated by phi times lambda kth power times the pseudo inverse of phi times u sub 0. All right, let's check if indeed the pseudo inverse of phi is x inverse times w transpose. Because phi will be a tall matrix, meaning more rows than columns, its pseudo inverse is defined as phi conjugate transpose times phi, the whole thing, inverse times phi conjugate transpose. Since phi is w times x, we can replace phi with w times x, which gives us that wx conjugate transpose times wx, the whole thing, inverse times wx conjugate transpose. This conjugate transpose can go into the parentheses, giving us x conjugate transpose times w transpose times w times x, the whole thing inverse times wx conjugate transpose. Since w transpose times w is identity matrix, we get x conjugate transpose times x, the whole thing inverse times wx conjugate transpose. We can bring this inverse inside of the parentheses, then we get x inverse times the inverse of x conjugate transpose times wx conjugate transpose. Now we can bring the conjugate transpose inside of parentheses, we get x inverse times the inverse of x conjugate transpose times x conjugate transpose times w transpose. Because the inverse of x conjugate transpose times x conjugate transpose is identity matrix, we finally get x inverse times w transpose, which proves that indeed the pseudo inverse of phi is x inverse times w transpose. All right, that was quite a derivation, but DMD is quite simple algorithm though. As a matter of fact, the whole algorithm can be easily summarized in one page. That is, you generate time dependent data, divide them into two matrices, one being u minus and another being u plus, perform truncated singular value decomposition of u minus matrix, then form a reduced operator a hat by multiplying singular value decomposition matrices to u plus matrix, perform eigenvalue decomposition on the reduced matrix a hat, set phi to be w times x, set b to be pseudo inverse of phi matrix times initial condition u 0, then finally, you can use this analytical DMD solution to predict any time and space field. Isn't it simple? Yes, indeed. If you use a high-level language such as MATLAB or Python, you can even implement DMD within 10 or 20 lines of code. By the way, we have implemented DMD in our C++ open source library for reduced total model, libROM. You are looking at one of the examples here, that is DMD for heat conduction problems, which you can find it in our libROM webpage. You will see that the corresponding full order model simulation takes 4.8 seconds, while DMD query time takes only 1.4 times 10 to the negative 3 seconds, which gives a speed up of around 3000. And the accuracy of DMD is pretty good, giving a relative error of 8.2 times 10 to the negative 4. By the way, this is reproductive case where DMD is trying to predict the existing training data, which is not practical. We do have parametric DMD examples also available in libROM, but let's talk about it in next tutorial video. By the way, you may wonder why we need C++ version of DMD if it can be easily implemented in either Python or MATLAB with a few lines of code, right? It is because we would like to apply DMD to a large scale data, say data size of millions or even billions. Just to give you a sense of how our C++ version of DMD works, here is a plot that shows how long its DMD training takes in seconds as we increase the size of data up to around 100 million. For each data size, we used 8 MPI processes. As you can see, for the largest data size of about 100 million, the DMD training was done less than 8 seconds. This is very fast because if you have to train a neural network, for example, with data size of 100 million, it will take hours and hours, even with multiple GPUs. By the way, I will leave the command line options for libROM to generate these results in the description section below so that you can try it yourself. All right, this was it today. I will see you again with another libROM tutorial in near future. I hope you will become a fan of libROM. Don't forget to click the like button.